Hi friends, Amy McMillan here, a vestibular physical therapist in Northeast Ohio. Today, I am bringing you a video because I've been talking to a ton of people through evaluations and reviewing their case through my vestibular coaching program. And one of my first questions is, what kind of test have you had? And I am so surprised at how many people have not had or have not been advised to experience a VNG. So today's video is all about VNG, video nystagmography, what it is good for, the parts, why you need it, and what it means if you do have one, and what the results are going to mean. So when you have dizziness or imbalance, and your provider is trying to figure out if it is an inner ear or brain problem, anything communicating with that vestibular apparatus from the brain to the ear, a VNG is one of the most valuable tests that you can get. So I'm very surprised at how many people still do not get a VNG. So video nystagmography is a test that would be prescribed and administered primarily by an audiologist. There is a VNG and an ENG. The VNG basically just involves specialized goggles that you'll be using for the provider to measure any involuntary eye motion called a nystagmus. And the ENG is the same thing. We're collecting information about eye movement, which gives us information about the inner ear. However, there are almost little contacts that are put on your eye with electric coils that go to a computer system that allow the computer to see what the eyes are doing. So in my experience, the VNG has been more prominently used in our area of Ohio. So who should get a VNG? Anyone who has dizziness, imbalance issues, and it has not been identified, BPPV needs to be ruled in or ruled out. Basically, anyone with dizziness or imbalance issues should get a VNG. So what it is measuring is the function of your vestibular nerve, the possibility of BPPV, and also it can measure through eye movement any abnormalities from the brain causing dizziness. So it is looking for peripheral, meaning nerve, positional BPPV, or central of the brain. So the three parts of a VNG are going to be ocular motor screening, which is just going to be different eye motions. So when you have your goggles on, they are looking for what's called a spontaneous nystagmus. If you're just sitting there at rest and your eyes are just kind of beating back and forth or up and down, that's called a spontaneous nystagmus, and that would just be marked. And the interpretation would be based on other results. The second part of the ocular motor screen is the smooth pursuit, which is just following a light back and forth to see if your eyes can stay on track. That is a function of the brain or cerebellum. So if that was abnormal, we would put that in a central sign. They're also looking for saccades, which is the ability of the eye to basically look back and forth to little flashes of light. Again, they're looking for the speed, whether it is too slow or too fast, whether it undershoots or overshoots, called hyper or hypometria. Depending on your age and depending on other signs, that could be normal or it could be in a central sign. There's also something called an OKN that sometimes is administered where your eyes are watching a strip or a light that goes past you. Again, they're looking for the eyes to be able to stay on target. If that was abnormal, that again would be in the central signs. So first is ocular motor screening. The second that we're looking at is positional testing. So that is going to look at any nystagmus when you lay onto your back, when you're put into a head hanging over the edge of the bed or in the chair, they would tip a chair below horizontal and see if they could trigger a nystagmus. If it's BPPV, it'll have a certain presentation. If it is central of the brain, it will have a different presentation. So again, that will be interpreted by your audiologist or physician. The last piece of the puzzle is the caloric test. Now, this is probably tried and true, like the hallmark test, the gold standard, to see if you have a weakness, a hypofunction of the vestibular nerve. And remember, the vestibular nerves, whenever you move your head, they give information to the brain to tell us where we are in space. So we want those vestibular apparatus to be on point, to be able to measure how much we're moving. What the audiologist is going to do is put a small burst of either cold air or water into your ear, which stimulates the vestibular nerve. If you have no dizziness with that test, or very little dizziness with that test, they'll be able to calculate how strong that signal is and then give you a result, whether it's normal or abnormal. If you don't have a lot of dizziness during that test, that may be a sign that you have weakness. If you experience a lot of dizziness during that stimulation, you probably do not have hypofunction. You have full signals going to the brain. So what does this tell you? If you have decreased function of the vestibular nerve, you would be diagnosed with a hypofunction, and they would be able to tell you if it's one side or both sides. Clinically significant, it depends on the labs. You may see that it'll say something like left vestibular hypofunction 28% of normal, for example. So depending on the lab, anywhere from 26 to 28 has been the cutoff in my experience. So if it says 13% below normal, that should not be significant enough to give you symptoms. I have had a patient with 23% decreased function, and they experienced some hypofunction symptoms. If in your test they found that you had a clinical weakness of your vestibular nerve, you would be a great candidate for vestibular rehab and gaze stabilization exercises. Now, I have plenty of videos on gaze stabilization and hope to do more, but make sure you check out my playlist on hypofunction and gaze stability if you do need some ideas of exercises. But remember, eyes moving like this or like this don't balance the vestibular system. It doesn't work the apparatus, it doesn't work the nerves. You have to do exercises that involve eye and head motion to work out the ear. So if you've been diagnosed with hypofunction, make sure your therapist is giving you exercises like moving your head or moving your eyes and head together. And I know you're gonna tell me, I don't wanna do that because it makes you dizzy, but everything's modifiable. You need to do it slow and safely progress, but you have to move the head to challenge the ear and get better. Exercises like this don't do anything to strengthen a hypofunction. All right, so now we know what a VNG does and why I think it's important. So it's going to be able to establish, do you have weakness of the vestibular nerve? Do you have BPPV? Or do you have your vertigo coming from a central issue like the brain? So if you do have a peripheral issue, you're gonna be sent to your vestibular therapist or physiotherapist. If you do have some central abnormalities, you should expect to be scheduling with a neuro-otologist or neurologist who specializes in dizziness, so we can figure out what those central abnormalities are on your VNG. So hopefully you found that video helpful. If you have any questions, please drop them in the comments below. I know it can be a confusing topic, so open to answer any questions that you have. Until I see you next week, stay healthy, stay steady, and stay strong.